Hi, everybody, and welcome to Conscious Talk TV. And I am your host, Linda Summers, and we are providing information to bring awareness to humanity. And today's topic is the building of a new world with Sonja, one of our divine feminine. And so I would love to welcome Sonja to the show. Hey, Sonja.
Hey, Linda. Hi, Rick.
Yeah, and Rick is also going to be joining us too as well. So he's going to maybe say something. Tune in, whatever feels resonant.
I'd like to just kind of sit back here, but you know, because Sonja has quite a lengthy story to tell.
Yes.
And a very amazing story as well. And I'm just going to kind of sit here in the wing, and yeah, if you need me, I'm right here.
Awesome. Well, thank you for being here, and thanks for everybody joining
thank
us too
you.
That's tuning in. We appreciate you guys also.
This is about the most important interview ever, perhaps, upon the earth. it's amazing. So
yes. She's one special divine feminine, that's for sure.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
You're so welcome. Well, we just honor you, and I just really appreciate you being here and sharing your story and your adventures, and really what your message is here, you know, is that you've gone through the best and the worst, and it's okay. So I love that message, and we'll get to
it. Yeah, I've had quite a few adventures, that's for sure.
Well, let's begin with your awakening and your journey to where you've arrived at this place. I would love to begin there. That would be great.
Well, you know, it's I think I've had several awakenings. Mm-hmm. I think I was born with this special connection. Not that everyone's not special, because we all are special, but for whatever reason, I was able to see multidimensional and switch between the dimensions, where I was actually with Father as a child. He taught me things that, you know, I would never want my mother to know, but that she didn't teach me. Yeah, there's just the incredible lessons, or, you know, just the information that he shared with me, where, you know, it was physical for me. It wasn't just an astral travel. I was literally shifting out of my body with my consciousness there as a child.
Yeah.
So, which made me, you know, everybody says, oh, that's wonderful. It is. It's amazing. It's wonderful. But then you're also different when you come back here. So when he would tell me I had to come back here, I would get upset. And, you know, most of my pictures as a child in this reality, I'm frowning. And so, you know, my mother used to always say she would be just waited for me just to disappear any minute. So she knew I was different, you know.
Wow.
So it was quite incredible. I remember even in grade school, it would be like time would stop. And I was in third grade, actually, and the room, everybody in the room seemed to just be like in a slow motion type warping look. And then this portal would open up on the side of the wall, and Jeremiah, Joseph, and Joshua would come and get me. They'd be at the doorway, and I would always, they were laughing because I was worried that everybody could see them. You know, I was embarrassed, and they would be laughing, saying, come on, they can't see us. And so I would, you know, walk down the walkway, like between the desks. And I would just, as soon as I went through the portal there, I was with, you know, back at what I considered home.
Yeah.
With Father and family. So,
yeah.
Yeah, quite different. And of course, nobody believed me. Mama didn't. Well, they knew that I was different. It wasn't that they just didn't believe me. I think it was just, you know, in the 60s, it's just kind of far out there.
Yeah.
You know, now where more and more people are telling their stories, and they're not afraid to talk about it. Like, you know, what I think they were, you know, 50 years ago.
Oh, sure. Yeah, definitely. So, how was your mom with, I mean, was she, how was your mom with all that?
Mama was, As Rick knows, he knows a lot of the stories about Mama. My mama is very special.
Yes, she is. I love
she her. Has a this com- just completely divine connection that's just at her. I mean, she has arthritis and she's in a wheelchair, and I've never seen someone never have a bad day.
Wow.
Just, it's absolutely incredible. Her faith is just her connection to Father. She doesn't actually call Father Father. She just calls him God. But
yeah.
I think we all have our own personal connection to Father in our own, it's our own perception of how we see him. And that makes us, you know, our individual aspects of him. So, yeah. But her connection is just extremely strong to where her faith, I mean, I just, I don't know anybody else like that. Yeah. But she doesn't take any medication at all. And you would think that she would be in such pain, you know, and she would be going to the doctor. She doesn't believe in doctors. I mean, she totally relies on Father. Mm-hmm. And sings, you know, wakes up singing. It's almost unnerving because I'm not really, I need my, you know, Sonja time in the morning. And I'm like, Mama, you got to stop all that doorstay stuff. So she, after I got older, you know, throughout my lifetime, you know, I would be, you know, she considered them prophecies. You know, she's got books and books of stuff that took place that I don't even remember. A lot of the stuff I don't remember where what happened, like what, okay, so say if it happened in front of her, her perception of what was taking place in my body, where I was like literally my consciousness had moved somewhere else, but my body was still functioning in front of her. Mm-hmm. And I would be giving her messages as this was taking place. So I really didn't know what I had said, or I didn't know. I would just know that when I would come back, my consciousness was coming back in my body, the look on her face, or if there were other family members around, would be like, you know, they would just be like shocked. Yeah. So then I would start crying. You know, I didn't know. I didn't like being so different, but I didn't want to give up my time with Father either. So, you know, that trade-off was, you know, it was worth it.
Yeah, absolutely. And now she has all the books, you said, of all that stuff.
Oh, she's got, girl, she's got a table full of stuff. Yeah, she keeps it all right there by her. And yeah. You know, she'll call me and remind me of certain things. You remember when you prophesied? Not this or that. That's what she calls it. Everybody calls it something different, you know. They call it channeling, and there's all those different words now. It's all the same thing, but you know, and you get a message, and from her perspective, she said that you know the difference. She says there's no doubting it. It's too it touches you in a spot that you can't be touched otherwise.
Yeah.
It's like a protected space, and it's kind of a she said you stop whatever you're doing when it happens. So, yeah. And also too, she's watched me, you know, she's my mama. She watched me, you know, I would be walking and what I would see, wouldn't be what everybody else would see. So, I wouldn't see what was in the physical reality that we were actually walking, and I would run into posts or whatever, because I didn't see them there because I was seeing something else.
Right.
Wow. So I got knocked out. Completely out several times. Just run into a tree or something, because I was totally not in this. My consciousness was, you know, with his Father. So
right. So as you got older, so where did it change? You know, can you kind of give us this timeline of?
Well, yeah, it started changing because, you know, as you get up in school and the peer pressure and you know, you're trying to be as normal as you possibly can. But I say it changed. I think I just, even though I grew up a little bit, it wasn't as innocent anymore. Okay, so when it's just, when you're little and you don't have any responsibilities, you know, you're free. And so as the responsibilities grew, one part of me looks back at it and I think, well, it was different, but it was the same. But I don't remember most of school. I don't remember. My sister remembers all this and she says, yeah, you know them. I know, I don't know them. Because I was, I think, checking out. I mean, they called it Sonja's checking out again. Well, that's not really what I was doing. I was actually, my consciousness was shifting. Mm-hmm. So I think that I was shifting more like between the ages of maybe 13 and 17, somewhere in there, 16, 17. Mm-hmm. Because I don't even remember, I don't remember things that I should hear, but I remember everything there, mm-hmm. which is, I've always found quite odd. But it was, you know, I don't remember, I can remember going to graduation and I don't know how I got there. I don't know how, I didn't know, this is the truth, I didn't know if I was going to actually graduate or not. It was the most uncomfortable feeling in the world to be sitting with your classmates and not know if they're going to call out your name because I shifted there. I was, my consciousness was somewhere else and I shifted there. I have no idea how I got there. So it was quite incredible on a constant basis. It never stopped. It just never stopped. Well, so you miss out on a lot and then you don't know what you did when you were here. You know, so you're walking into something. You're like, Sonja, good grief, why didn't you pay attention? Well, I was paying attention, but I was paying attention somewhere else. So my consciousness wasn't really, and I've had these conversations with Rick, you know, for years, just like, how is that possible? You know, I would be so, I felt so weird and, you know, really didn't start sharing to this depth until I met Rick. Mm. And because he knew Father like I did, it was easy for me to share that because, you know, we were raised Catholic until we were probably, I don't know, I guess I was about 10. And I can remember, I'd just get in trouble. We had to go to catechism and I'd get in trouble because they would say, oh, well, you can't see Father's face or you'll burn or whatever that was. I mean, remember now, but I'd be like, what, he's standing right there beside you, what are you talking about? Right, you know,
exactly.
So, you know, it's right here. So I learned to, in this society, in this reality, just to keep my mouth shut, not to get in trouble, because I stood in the corner a lot and or got sent home or whatever, because if I spoke my truth, you know, what I actually saw out of my own eyes, you know, they thought I was needed medications or, you know, I've been to, and mother took me to the doctor because the school would require me to have to go to the doctor because they thought something was wrong with me. And she took me and he would just say I had a vivid imagination. So we just go home. But, you know, it's, the system is really crazy like that. So,
yeah. Well, something interesting you said, when you speak your truth, you know, it's like when we speak our truth, the outside world, if the outside world shuts you down, you learn not to speak your truth and just not saying.
Well, even now, yeah, I mean, even now, my nerves, you know, like I was telling y'all earlier before we even came on, some of the things that happen as the result of speaking your truth is not always comfortable. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, I had anxiety before we even got on the call because of, you know, some of the prior interviews that I had done. It wasn't anything that the, you know, the people did. I think it was just something, this fear in me of being in front of people from my childhood, trying to talk about it. And then these weird, crazy things would happen to me afterwards. And, but I survived it and I learned from it, you know? So it's my higher self, you know, my subconscious or my superconscious or whatever, whichever level it is, trying to show me that, you know, let's get rid of this fear, you know, which can be controversial, you know, with a lot of people. They're like, well, fear is something that, you know, can rise in you at any given moment for no telling what reason. Mm-hmm. And I mean, used to, I would be afraid. Something like my friend said, oh, there's a demon out here. And I thought, well, I looked out there and I saw an angel. I didn't see, I've never seen anything bad. That was one thing. I've never seen any demons. Never, ever, ever. Yeah. And so I thought, well, why is she seeing it? Well, then I thought, and she's my friend. Why'd she scare me like that? You know? So I go out there and I'm looking and there's, I'm seeing this, you know, this light, this really pretty blue and purple stuff around it. And then you could kind of see the outline of the angel. And I thought, why is she doing that? And then, you know, I had to conquer that fear. So the next night I was scared because I was thinking, what if that demon's out there and he's going to come here and get me? Yeah. So I walked outside and Rick knows I've talked to him through all this and I stood out there and I just stood there and I was scared, but I stood there until I realized, then I got to thinking, well, it's dark out here. I live, you know, kind of out in the country. I've always lived out in the country. So, you know, there could be a snake or a raccoon or something. I thought, okay, I've had enough of fighting this fear. But then you can put it on the same table and say, well, if you have a fear of, as my friend brought up earlier, she said, well, if you have a fear of getting run over, are you going to go stand in the street? You know, so you have to use a balance, and you have to find your authentic self in the middle somewhere, and don't go overboard either direction. It's kind of like, you know, you've got to get on that balance beam and try to stay there as much as possible.
Yeah.
Well, does that make sense?
Yeah, it does, for sure. And then don't you think, too, that in this time that we're in, because since, you know, Trump is bringing up all these truths, and, you know, of course, people are, the outside world, you know, is doing their thing and, you know, looking at it as being afraid, but that, you know, bringing truth to light and the reality of what is really
well, the reality, as far as my, you want my perspective on it?
Yes.
What I think it is.
Yes, definitely. Of course.
From my own personal experience, and just mine, I'm not even gathering information from anyone else, but what happened to just me inside this body, and up until I'm 54, I'll be 55 in May, it is, I see things multidimensional. So I see things as there's all these different layers, and there's a version of me in all these different layers. And sometimes my choices can make me go one direction or another. But as those unfold, and as you learn, and as your wisdom grows, you know, some of the stuff falls to the wayside. You know, it's kind of like the Mandela effect. These things are, it's shifting constantly. It's just constantly things, like, it's like the whole Ed McMahon thing. I mean, anybody of any age at all remembers Ed McMahon being in the Publishers Clearinghouse. I mean, that's like a huge one. So it's like, as we move through this and we're shifting and we're growing and we're learning, things change. The dimensions change, they fall off, and something new is there. And it's a constant moving in every single direction, up, down, sideways, here and there. And, you know, think about that. If you start waking up in the middle of that, what's that going to be for you? That's going to be a cluster. It's not always, you know, I can understand someone that just woke up one day. You know, I personally was blessed with this, born like this, but I have friends that just one day started seeing stuff, and it scares you, and you don't understand. And, but you have to know that nothing in your space is, it can't be in your space unless it's in you. And you can look at that, and you can start gauging it. You can start working on your individual self. And then we start, you know, then you can start seeing the difference in the collective. And that's when these huge Mandela effects start happening. Did I get off track? I think I got off track.
Well, yeah, I mean, just the perspective, but no, I think it's all tying in for sure.
Yeah. Because some of the stuff that Trump says, I learned how to decode a couple of years ago. It just came to me one day, and he's the, all, you know, words, our language barrier is huge. You know, everything is lost in translation. So you have to go with your intuition, your gut feeling. You have to go with your, cause I'm extremely empathic, so I can feel all this stuff taking place. So I think, okay, now you can look at him, and you can put 10 people there, and they're all going to have a different opinion of what is going on, because they're really in their own individual realities watching this take place as a whole.
Yeah.
I mean, so, you know, on one hand, it can become really confusing. And on the other hand, to me, it's like opening up, and all of a sudden you start seeing what he's really saying, and how, and then you start seeing what he's really doing. You know, so I think every person on the planet has this ability to make these huge changes. They just don't know it. Mm-hmm. They just don't know that they can do it.
Right.
So.
Well, that kind of goes back to originally, like, your awakening, how you arrived. How did you arrive? I mean, I know spending a lot of time with Father, you know, that's definitely in that world, you know, well, just with Father, that it's a big difference, you know what I mean, than being here in the physical and going through everything that, you know, as
Well, it was a little different. Yeah, it was a little different for me. It wasn't like some of the people that, you know, they had this huge, you know, light come in and it was this happened or a rainbow or this or that. It didn't happen for me like that. It's just like, because I already see so much. Yeah. And I think as I got older, I would try to tune it out because it's very difficult. If you can imagine standing in one spot and then if I look at something, okay, so say for instance, I'm in my living room and I look at the coffee table. If I put any focus at all, if I mean, I've learned how to make it like slow down a little bit, but I can look at that and I can see the person who built it. I can go back further. I can actually, everything for that coffee table to be in my living room in its existence, I can even go all the way back to the tree, back to the sapling, back to the trees next to it. And then I can look around in that area. And I guess that's maybe remote viewing is what they call it now. Oh, my ears are really shifting. So we must be getting to a really good subject because my ears are, I can feel it shifting. There's, you know, I can look around and I can see people standing out there and then look at the timetable and, you know, it's a whole different timeline. You know, it's incredible, but I can actually get lost in that too. Yeah. So then I lose time. That's when I start losing time. I used to have to be really careful, not anymore as much. I've learned how to kind of get my, you know, wrap myself around it. But if I was driving down the road, all of a sudden, if I look over at a stop sign, I can see the guy that put the stop sign there. I can see where he works. I can see his family. I can see his cousin's mother's aunt, and they're all having dinner. And, you know, so it just, that's how I see things to where, you know, you're literally, I can put myself in that space and watch. And there for a while, I always thought, oh, that might be invading their privacy. You know, I don't want to watch them eat, you know.
Right.
So I'd call Rick and I said, am I invading the privacy? You know, I'd be like, I don't know. I'm seeing all this stuff. But I've always seen it, but I never really started understanding it. I think when I started understanding I don't want to call them gifts and abilities because my source connection, that's what I want to call it. When I started understanding my Father God source connection, mm-hmm. was probably around, you know, started like in, had a huge deal in 2009 and then again in 2015 when I met Rick. And I actually met Rick and another friend of mine at the same, right around that same little time space, maybe a couple of years there. And that's when I started understanding more metaphysical things and how, how these things were possible for them to actually happen to me, you know, the physics of it. Mm-hmm. Then it went on to another huge awakening like last year when I understood physics to the point that I could go inside of me through my heart chakra and end up in alternate universes to where I could travel, which I was always able to jump into wormholes and stick my head out and I'd be like at the North Pole, or then I would be, you know, there was a polar bear there and I was actually able, me and my friend were like walking through there and we could talk on the phone and travel, astral travel like that. It was incredible.
Yeah, I love that.
So there's all these other, it's not limited to this right here, yeah. But we're just not there yet to do it physically. We will be, but not yet. That's my own personal perception.
Very close.
Yes. Yes. I do believe that we are getting close because I don't think I would even be talking to y'all right now otherwise, because I had become a hermit, you know, I just trying to figure it out. I didn't want to give any disinformation. Yeah. You know, I didn't want to tell somebody something that, I didn't want to lead anybody down another rabbit hole or another yellow brick road. I don't want to do that. I just don't. And so until I felt comfortable enough in my own skin to where I had integrated enough of, and I had done enough clearing, and I've done hours and hours and I mean days and hours of work, just working on myself, learning breathing techniques and seeing how it, if yeah, I would trial and error it. So say if I breathe into my heart chakra and I open it up like a bulb, and then I can, as I exhale that energy, because if I'm pulling from source, which is not outside of me, but from my existence inside of me, my own essence, I can fill that up, that bulb up, and then as I exhale, I can push it out through and make things happen. You know, I mean, literally, it's incredible. It some people, it kind of freaks them out because they can feel that energy. But if I were consciously aware of every single thing that I was doing, though, I would be able to change more, which I have to honestly say I'm not quite there yet. I've had some incredible, I mean, astronomical experiences, but until I can harness this, and I'm close, I'm getting really close, because, you know, I've moved a few things, you know, on purpose.
I'd like to say, Sonja, may I share
I would love for you to.
Well, you know, the one I love to get on is about CERN very quickly.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was pretty cool.
If I may, I'll try to keep it a brief story. So anyhow, I'm sitting in my camper up in Saskatchewan, and I'm in a small town. Alberta. Yeah. And I'm in a small town in northern Alberta, and it's in the summer. We just had a lot of heavy downpours. The streets were becoming very flooded in areas, and I'm sitting in my camper looking at the weather, and I'm speaking with Sonja. And so what I see is a huge... let's say part of a storm coming, very dark clouds, and the prevailing winds are from the west, and it's coming right towards the town. And what occurred, more so by Father, I said, it's time for me and Sonja to know more of what Sonja can do, more or less. So, so I'm the witness for this. So very quickly, what I said to Sonja is that I got a storm coming here, and I said, we don't want any more water, you know, it may cause accidents or what have you. And so I said, Sonja, see if you can divert the storm. So very quickly, I'm watching it, it's coming closer, and without saying what way to divert it, I believe, I knew it had to go southward and missed the town. So I'm watching the storm, and it's coming very rapidly. Then all of a sudden, as soon as Sonja begins, it stops and it goes south and misses the town. So, you know, no mistaking that she diverted it. So then, out of the blue comes from Father. He says, we got to shut down CERN. Right now, they're about to do an experiment. And for the viewers, what CERN was doing here is also, they were doing things, they're distorting time and space. And in my past, I repair many distortions and rifts that they have created. But that's another thing. However, Father said, you got to shut down CERN. So immediately, because Sonja can remote view, and as well, her gifts are are everything. So I say, Sonja, you got to get there and shut down CERN. Well, she says, I'm already here tearing out wires and wires and everything out. So she's already there. I said, good. And if I recall correctly, I said there's a couple junction boxes as well. And I was there in part, you know, getting visions of certain lights on counters and these sort of things. But that is irrelevant. So anyhow, Sonja said, yeah, got it all done in a couple minutes. And here she is in, you know, where she's at in the U.S. and I'm in Canada. And however, you know, we always trust that our gifts work. We know that. But what was hilarious about this is that she did it around the end of June, I believe, that year. And about a month, no, 2 months later, I run into a guy and the topic about CERN come up. And he said, did you hear what happened about CERN? My father had this all set up. And I said, no. Oh, he said a weasel chewed the wires off about a month ago. And I said, oh, really? So I said, I must look at this. So what I did is, you know, I couldn't wait to get on the computer, right, and search it out. And so I looked and looked at the date. And yes, you know, backtracked it. It was right at the time that Sonja had did this. And we had quite a joke about this because Sonja said they called me a weasel. But I mean, you know, there's your, but there was your confirmation, you know, she went in there and did it. But yeah. you know, the power of this, that let's say, you know, she did it with her mind, but it had actual physical results as well, which is, you know, very powerful. And there are more of the angels as well that have these sort of gifts. And, you know, they are. And this is one of the reasons, because of Sonja, you know, that I know what the angels here are capable of. And it's just amazing and beyond. And, you know, all of our intentions are good, you know, for humanity, right? And but just so beautiful. So I'll zip up. I just wanted to, you know, accreditate Sonja's abilities because I know.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing that. Wow. That's incredible.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. It's like something in a movie.
Real.
Yeah.
True reality show. You know? It's true.
Yeah, when those things actually manifest like that, it's confirmation that you can start trusting yourself. And you know, I've had bouts of thinking, you know, oh well, that don't mean nothing, you know, whatever, you know, and just try to, you'd have to be around me to understand the the extent of things like that happen around me. Yeah. It scares some people, you know, but it's kind of become a joke, like in my family, like when Sonja comes, be ready. But wow. Most of the stuff, it's not like, right. But I have to say most of the stuff, it's, you know, I don't even think about it. It's not like it's not like I like set out to say, oh, I'm going to do this and show somebody something. It's not like that.
Right.
These things that happen sometimes, I, you know, it even amazes me, but I always look at it as, okay, what is this showing me? What is this teaching me? It's teaching me something. Anything that manifests around me is teaching me something. Yeah. And I must be a busy, always what we call a racehorse, Rick. I'm gonna push it to the limit. And you know, I'm really hard-headed too, so maybe that is, you know, another reason. It's just like I'm not going to accept that no one else can experience this. They're going to experience it if it's the last thing, and they're going to experience it because it's for everybody. Can do it. Yeah. They just don't know it. They just have to do it. Trust that little voice in your head. It is incredible when you start just knowing yeah. It's true.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah. Well, do you think too for yourself, I mean, when it's so embedded in you and it is you, that it just comes natural, right? So it's like,
yeah, it's just natural for me. I never knew any different.
Yeah.
So then when I would try to explain it to somebody, you know, for years I couldn't get the words right, and yeah, I still don't. I don't know, like, a lot of the words. I'm not real educated on the correct words with, you know, when some of the, like, video channels and stuff, they know all the right words and stuff. It's not like that for me. I didn't study any of it. I was every bit of it. It's amazing to me because it's something that will come to me. And then I'll see someone else talking about it. And I'll think, yeah, that's the words. That's the words right there, because I have the energy of it and I see it taking place, but they know how to put the words to it, you know? So sometimes my words don't really, match that of somebody that, you know what I'm talking about? It's kind of like, you know what I mean? I don't know how to say that. There's correct terminology that people use now where they can understand what you're talking about, where I can tell you what it feels like, looks like, or smells like, you know.
Right.
But there's actually terminology for it. But then it kind of gets distorted a little bit, because then it's like different perceptions of it. So I kind of like to stay in my own little bubble with that, because I can understand it without, because when you start adding words to it sometimes, that's when distortion starts taking place, because even the word good doesn't mean good, you know. So we use those words out of habit and out of trying to communicate with others, but they don't always mean what we think they mean. So then if you think about that, then you think, well, if I don't really know what I'm saying, right, and I'm really not understanding what I'm thinking, then I'm creating from a default place. So you got to get a handle on yourself, and you got to, if you really want to. Now, some people really don't want to, and that's fine too. You know, I mean it, but if you really want to, just go within. Everything that you want to know is inside of you. And if you have to just sit still, just be still and just listen to what comes up. If you have to write it down, write it down, but it will start happening, because if you're human, you've got it. That's what I believe. I truly believe that.
Yeah. Rick, you had something you wanted to say to that? You had your hand.
Just what I was going to, what Sonja was speaking about, because translating how we read things and energy and also the perspective, sometimes there's that communication gap from what we know and we perspect at a very high level, is what Sonja's speaking about. And we have to try to translate it down into words and labels that ones are familiar with there. And what I do, for instance, I translate things into scale of 4D, 5D, but really that is not the way that things are perceived. But we use these sort of analogies, and for instance, like an ascended master, most are familiar with that term and label, so I will use it, although what really happens is a little bit more complex with that. So what I'm just elaborating on is, you know, what Sonja is saying, that I also can attest to that sometimes it's difficult to put what we're receiving in words. And like Sonja's gifts are many, but one way that I receive is sometimes it'll just be images that will flash in a second, but you probably got a book's worth of knowledge there. So you try to condense it and formulate it and construct it in such a way that you can purvey it, more on more simple terms. And you need to, not to degrade anyone, but you need to put it down on the layman's terms as well, because what is happening is that many, you know, are not familiar with big words and big terms like Sonja is saying, because we are, I relate and to all different levels. So having said that, you know, there are many that are not educated to the great degrees in law and physics. I mean, you start using some of these long words, even I don't know what some of them mean, and sometimes I need to look them up. So there is a communication gap, but we're bridging that pretty good by using acceptable labels here, if you will.
I agree. It is getting the more people that are stepping out and just talking. You know, sometimes I know for myself, when that energy starts flowing, and sometimes I just need to I need somebody to be a backboard for me, just so I can get it out.
Yeah.
And even if the words aren't right, I have a few, my sister or my friend, I have my friend, and I'm like, girl, I just got to talk. And so I just, you know, start talking, and she's such a great listener. She's, I don't know what, sometimes I think I'd just be lost without her, because I've got to say this to somebody, you know, I have to, because when I get it out of me, then I can kind of see it a little differently. It's kind of like, you know, when you sometimes we should talk about fear.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes things seem so bad inside of you.
Yeah.
And then when you talk about it,
yeah,
and you get it out of you, and that's a motion of a release to say something about it.
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden you're like, oh, that wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. That was kind of silly. You know, and here you're all biting all your nails off and, you know, pulling at your eyebrows and stuff. And then you're like, that was just ridiculous. It was not that big of a deal, but it seemed huge inside of you.
Yeah.
You know, so that release of and you know, I can talk to myself. I always talk, you know, I just talk all the time. I'm always talking to whoever it is or at that moment. But
yeah,
it's not the same as having a human on the other end that's interacting with you. And then the reason I even brought this up is because, like, my friend Deborah, I can talk to her and I won't have the right words, but I can express this. Like, if I have this rock, call it my, I just had a download or a revelation or something, you know, came to me, and I can say it to her, and then she can listen, and then she can say it back to me. I'm like, yes, that's it. Yeah. So her words are different, totally different, but somehow or another, we will share this information, and it, or vice versa. If she tells me something and we can like get on this next level, it's like a seesaw effect.
Yeah.
It's really cool how I can see that energy. How we all of a sudden were like, oh yeah.
Yeah.
And you kind of get it then, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. What comes to me too, is when you were talking, is that really it's about this feeling. Cause sometimes, you know, that a lot of times when you're at that higher vibration, it is hard to put into words because you're not down, as Rick was saying, at these lower vibrations. So, but it is where you can actually feel the person. It's more of a feeling that it's like the soul knows. It feels like it's like, yes, it's resonating, right?
Yeah. So no matter what, you can feel that no matter what somebody's saying, you can feel what that is. You can, all of a sudden you see, either like Rick said, you see the picture of it in your head, or, you know, like even being able to connect to somebody and travel through wormholes, you know, you can connect with somebody and you can like take them with you, and and then you start seeing the same thing. It's really incredible because you're traveling the same space when you connect like that. So it's really something to sit back and watch all the different perspectives. I think it's just incredible.
Now, would you know when someone's ready? Because I love that idea. When you said that, I was like, oh my gosh, wouldn't it be great to go on a just travel with you? But I guess you'd have to really be. So I guess my question would be, where does that person have to be in order to come along with you? Like, say, if I wanted to go with you on a mission and I feel like, yeah, I feel I'm ready to do that. Is there something that you would know within my beingness?
I don't know. I think that it's more of it's an activation maybe when that kind of things happen. What do you think, Rick? I think that because I can take my grandkids.
Oh,
I can. Okay. My grandkids and I can sit on something and I can start talking about something, and then they get the visual, and then all of a sudden time has lapsed.
Yes.
You know, so we actually traveled and didn't know to someone else, they don't know that's what they're doing.
Right.
You don't realize that time has lapsed. You don't realize that, you know, you've actually done something other than just take them into a storyline or something. Yeah. So I notice, especially with my oldest granddaughter, I can really, because she's always working on her telepathic gifts, and we can talk. And you know, she's almost, she just, and it's not like I sat and talked to her about this kind of stuff, you know, so they're my grandkids. I mean, we do whatever, but it's not like I'm like, oh, I'm going up here and I'm going to talk to this specific kid. I'm going to make sure they're at this level so they can understand me. No, it's kind of like a flow that just happens and you just connect. I think everybody has it, whether they are, they think they do or not, because if the children, I mean, yes, the children are probably born more activated these days, you know, compared to what, you know, some were years ago, but I can meet somebody in the grocery store. I could be biased. Maybe it's just not difficult for me. I don't know. What do you think, Rick?
Well, yeah, I see what you're saying though, too. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, no, you have to have the gift and have the way to tap into it. But just being blunt with the whole thing, the way society is today, again, you know, the way public school systems are set up, but also the way the parents were conditioned, that all the children have these gifts. But I mean, today, the time they are 3 and 4 years old, you know, they're going to preschool and they're being conditioned to fit into a society that does not support the gifts. And so very quickly, you know, a lot of these children are robbed of their divine gifts and placed into this mundane. Now, the point with that is that, as Sonja said, today there are many of these children that are born with these gifts, and they can utilize them very quickly. But also, if they're kept away from the conditioning, like the homeschooling children or what have you, you know, it is better for them. But there is nothing is set in stone. You know, as Sonja Sharon and her granddaughters are very, very special. Well, pretty well all of her grandchildren, in the terms of having their divine gifts turned on. But also, you know, for what I feel with that, that is because of who and what Sonja is, the divine one as well.
Yes.
She does influence and keeps things strong and supports their gifts. And that does make a difference. But, you know, let's say that a lot of children's gifts were turned off, you know, because of that. So, yeah.
Well, yeah, you know, my grandson, he's 3. His name is Cooper. And he, I've never taught him. It's almost like it's a transfer or something, because his mother's very intuitive, but he's 3 and he will not eat anything. He smells it, and then he takes his little fingers and he clears it, and then he smells it again, and then he clears it, and then you can tell he's literally blessing this food before he puts it in his mouth. And you can't make him eat something. You know, I've tested, after I noticed it, my daughter's like, look at what he's doing. Why is he doing that? And I said, he's clearing his food. Oh my gosh. So, and if you, I mean, it doesn't matter what it is. He is going to smell of it and clear it. That's how he tests it to see, and he gets it to the vibration that he needs it to be. It's incredible to watch. It's absolutely incredible to watch. It's funny. Yeah.
I love that. I love that.
Very special. Yes.
And something I wrote down too, when you were talking, both you and Rick, is that when I had asked you the question about, can you, if I wanted to go on, take, you know, if we wanted to go on a trip or a journey or a mission, I feel too, it's all about intent, right? So it's our intent of what we want to do. Cause I know there's been 2 times in my life that I've energetically have tapped into 2 people where I actually was there. I actually felt them. And the first time it scared me because I was like, oh my gosh, you know, and then I came, you know, immediately back because I didn't realize that what I actually did. And then the second time was very much intentional. And I mean, like you said, we're all energetic beings, right? And so we have this, what I hear you saying is that we have this within us to be able to do it. But of course, it's always for the ill, you know, for it's always for the betterment, the good. It's not like you're doing anything ill out of intent, ill intent, you know?
Right. So, yes, it's like if you set your intentions, yes, okay, so there's different people that live in different parts of the world that, you know, we can meet in the astral realm and we can, you know, set your intent at 10 o'clock tonight, let's go travel over here, go travel over there, and, you know, you're both there.
Yeah.
It works. It really does work.
Yeah, totally.
There's a lot of people that have done that, you know, for years. It's normal to them to be able to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and that's what I want everybody to understand is that don't ever think that you can't do it because it hasn't happened yet. Because if you are here and if you can hear my voice, you can do it.
Yeah.
It is already in you. Yeah. It's just you. Just start activating it. Start, try it. Don't look at somebody else to do it for you. Just do it, try it, and then try it again and do it again. And then the next time, I mean, to the point to where I can have a dream, and if I don't like how it ends, I go back and change. It's like I can see it go and rewind, and then it ends differently.
Wow.
So I think that you just get stronger and stronger and stronger. And don't get me wrong, there'll be something that'll come along that'll slap you down and make you say, you know, you're crying and you're going, oh my God, what is going on here? I just want to go home, you know? Well, then you wake up and then you get up again, you put your pants back on, you say, okay, I got it this time. I got it. It's kind of like riding a bicycle. You just keep doing it. Keep trying because it's there. I guarantee you it's there.
Yeah. Yeah. So do you want to talk about some of your experiences, or we can even go into what do you feel to share? Like, what do you feel that you want to share?
We can talk about the diamonds if you want to.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also want to talk about what we talked about earlier before the show. You know, about how the word we used, that I used.
I can't remember.
Magic.
Oh,
you want to talk about that? Yeah. So do we want to show, should we show you know what, do you want to tell the story of the diamonds first and then I'll show the video?
Okay.
Or would you rather show the video first and then the diamonds? I think maybe the video first.
It doesn't matter to me. I think you could probably show it while I'm talking.
Okay. So
it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna show where you're talking. So I think that'll be important. Thank you for that. And then anybody that hasn't seen, and the one that I did post up was kind of distorted, so you really couldn't see it. So Sonja had sent me another one that is very, very clear, and that I'm going to show you guys. So let me wait till it starts all over again. Okay. I'm just gonna let it run a couple times.
Okay. Well, I had. Anybody, I said I'm hard-headed, and I have a tendency to, if I can't, like, I couldn't heal it. I had a bad tooth, and I couldn't heal it, and I was mad, and I was getting mad. I was just mad all over. I had to go to the dentist, and I thought, now, why would I have to do this? I mean, I've healed an autistic girl. I've pulled people out of comas. I've done all these amazing things and I can't heal my own tooth. You know, and the pain was excruciating and my face full up and it was just hideous. So I go to the dentist and I was already mad and I couldn't shake it. So I'm normal too. You know, I'm normal just like everybody else. So I'm coming back from the dentist and I'm still mad because I had to go. I'm being a brat. I'm being a real big brat. And so I could admit that. Sure. So that was right before where I live. I needed to stop at the grocery store. And I thought, I'm just going to run into this dollar store here because my face was still feeling bad. So anyhow, I go in there and I come out and I get in my truck And all of a sudden I hear Father say, get back out of your truck. And I'm like, no, I'm not doing it. You're not making me do it.
Right.
He's like, Sonja, get out of the truck. And yeah, I'm being a brat. I'm going to say it. I'm being a real big brat. And so I'm like, you know, I this is stupid. If I can't fix my own tooth, why would I want to, you know, pretty much hold on and listen to you? That's why my husband sleeps on the other end of the house half the time, because I'm arguing with God, and it kind of scares, freaks him out a little bit.
You shouldn't be arguing with God, he's probably saying, right?
Yeah. So I said, yeah, okay. Finally, you know, when Father's talking to you like that, you can sit there and say what you want to say. Yeah. But, you know, even if I'd have drove off, I'd have turned around and went back, because what are you going to miss?
Right.
What would I have missed? You know, so I'm sitting there and I'm pouting. You know, I'm a grown woman sitting there pouting and not even aware. You know, people are probably looking at me thinking, who's this woman talking to or whatever. So finally I get on my truck and I let it down, and they needed to mow their grass. So I did notice that, that the grass had not been mowed. So because this, all of a sudden there's this diamond sitting right there on the top of this little, you know, little bunch of grass right there. So I pick it up, and he said, you know, like, I guess I'm so mad still, I just get in the truck. I'm like, is this it? And I, you know, it was like a confirmation yes. And so I just stick it in my purse and I go home and get in my chair, and I'm sitting in my chair, and I'm, you know, I'm allergic to any kind of pain meds, so I can't take anything, you know, so I'm sitting here, you know, in my own suffering, pitying myself. So, no, why did I have to go through this?
Still mad at Father. I would have been too.
Oh, God, yeah, I was mad. I'm like, why did I have to do all this? It was stupid. And, you know, whine. So, I never looked at it again. So, 11:30 that night, he woke me up. He's like, Sonja, why don't you go look at your diamond? And I'm thinking, are you kidding me? First I have to go through all this pain, and now you want me to get up at 11:30 at night and look at the diamond? So I got up out of bed and I go look, and I thought, oh wow. And I said, it looks like a Z to me. I mean, it looks like a knock, like something you get out of the, what do you call it, the little gumball machines?
Yeah.
And so I just laid it on this, on my little, this little container on the dresser, and I went back to bed. So next morning, it was a different story. I get up and I could feel this different energy coming from it. And I thought, wow. So I end up, another one appears there on the dresser beside it. And I thought, okay, this is getting kind of weird now. You know, what is this? And I could like hear them. It was like I could hear this little bitty voice, you know, just kind of like reminded me of like a little fairy voice or a little, you know, I used to hear that years ago when I would hear these little fairies on this piece of property I had, and they would say, truffles, an amazing treat. So they were kind of like this little bitty, like fairy world kind of voice to it.
Yeah.
And I thought, okay, I'm losing it today. You know, whatever. But it kept talking and it kept talking and it kept talking. So finally I get them out and I'm looking at them. I put them in my hand, and all of a sudden I hear it yawning like a baby and opened its eyes. And I thought, but then the light in my living right there where the bar is at, in the kitchen area, like dining room area, was actually it's a kitchen with, you know, the big lights, the overhead lights. And so that they didn't like the lights, and they were going, oh, no. And so I thought, oh, gosh. Just like an infant. It was crazy. So I go in there in the dining room, which is on the other side of the kitchen, where there's – and I closed all the blinds and had all – you know, all the lights were off. I turned off all the lights. There was no reflection in there. And then I looked again, and it started yawning again and opening its little eyes and just batting its eyes like what a newborn baby does when it first wakes up in the mornings, you know. And oh my gosh, I could just feel it. And I thought, oh my, you know how people do when you see a baby, you're talking to it like it's a little bitty baby. And I said, oh my goodness, looky here, where are you? Then I thought, oh my gosh, I got to get a video of this. So I grabbed my phone I missed the whole yawning part because that part was absolutely precious. But I caught, that's the part that I caught. Yes. And yeah. I have a lot of videos of them, you know, projecting stuff. Like you can see inside of there where it looks like, you know, different locations. So it's almost like someone said, I guess I've never dealt with a, what is it called? A crystal skull, but they say crystal skulls can do that, or, you know, a crystal ball or whatever. But these actually have like this life force in them. And I ended up coming, six appeared. There was three round ones, three square ones. And then later I had two teardrop ones appear. Now the two teardrop ones never seemed to be alive. I don't know why. They still look foggy. The others all at one point or another have opened their eyes and looked at me. And I could tell that, you know, there was three females and three males, you know, the energy on it. They, for the longest time, they would talk to me and, you know, would actually, I would carry them everywhere I went. If I didn't, I could hear them, you know, come back. And, it doesn't matter if anybody believes me or not. It was something for me it's kind of like, you know, even with all the experiences that I've had, it's like, are you kidding me? This is incredible. And why would this happen? So then I have to ask myself, why did these, you know, I know that we shifted, you know, with my experience, to me, we shifted dimensions, and that's how, you know, something shifted to where I was able to physically pick this up. Yeah. And I know that they're from a higher dimension because of the information that they've given me. It's information that's on a higher level, that's more advanced information. That would be hard. Some of it's hard to find words to even describe. Yeah. So I do know that they are from a different dimension, but then one disappeared. And just as quick as they appeared, one of the small round ones disappeared. And sometimes I can feel it, like, it would be close by. So say if we're rotating, and I can, all of a sudden, it doesn't matter what I'm doing, I can feel it because they have their own energy signature. And I can feel it just for a brief little bit, but it's almost like something didn't shift to where it actually shifted to where I got my hands back on it again, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if everything's moving and everything is constantly gravitating and it's constantly moving and expanding and, you know, contracting and, you know, different things are shifting in and out to where we're not even aware that there are so many things happening when you're sitting still.
Right.
You know, at that very moment, I wasn't able to actually get my hands on it to get it out of where it was at. So it's teaching me along the way of where this space is that it's actually at. I know where this space is at. If I had it on a map, I could point it out where it's at and how it's moving according to the Earth's rotation even.
Yeah. Wow. I love that. And I love, if anybody, the viewers could see where they were actually blinking and the littlest one moved.
Yes. And I did not move my hand. Right. I don't know if you noticed that. I never moved my hand.
No, your hand was completely still. Yeah.
Yeah. So it was, and they do move around. That's one thing I have noticed, whether they're face down or I can put them in there. Cause I had them, I've tried different little beds for them. You know, it's kind of like having little babies, and I tried little beds for them and it didn't seem to work. And so they even started kind of losing some of their life force for a little bit. And I didn't know what to do. You know, it's like you can, you can't feed them or nothing. You don't know what to do. So, and I'm listening to them, but it just didn't seem to work. Well, Rick suggested that I put them in a basket. And I've found this perfect little weaved basket, and I put them in there. But even, you know how weaving is, it has like, it's not just real flat.
Right.
So it's not, and they're set up to where, you know, the babies can't, you know, my grandkids can't get them, or, you know, nobody can touch them where they're sitting, but they will flip themselves over.
Oh, gosh.
If I put them face up, when I go back in there, I guarantee you they're going to be flipped over. Wow. Every single time. It is the most incredible thing you've ever seen.
Wow.
So they have the ability to move, which I think is just astonishing. I mean, you know, that to me is just in here in my own little space, these little things like this happening, you're just like, wow.
Yeah.
You
know?
So,
yeah.
Now,
go ahead.
I was going to say something. Oh, I took them to a jeweler because I thought that they were just the very next day after the second one appeared, I took them down to a local jeweler. And because I thought they were, I really thought that some little kid dropped it outside of the dollar store or something, like they'd gotten out of the gum machine or whatever.
Yeah.
And he told me that there was not a machine that he had access to that I needed to take it to an archaeologist because of its cut, that they were like ancient, that they were not like what you would be able to go and buy. You couldn't really put a dollar. Not that I was trying to sell them. You can't sell nothing like that. You just can't when something is placed in your presence like that. You just, you hang on to it. But it's kind of like there's not a, he didn't know of anyone that had a machine. I'd have to go to an archaeologist.
Wow.
So I knew that was my validation that it wasn't just
a seed.
Yeah. Or just a nothing, but it was more than just, yes.
Yeah. Sonja, did he verify that they were diamonds? And what did he say they were?
Yes, they were the first one I found was 3.3 carats, and the biggest one there. And he said it was definitely a diamond, but that he just didn't have the equipment to tell me any more about it. He had just never seen anything like it. So he told me not to leave them anywhere. He did tell me that.
Yeah.
He said, he said, I know the first thing people want to do is have them mounted or whatever. He said, but I don't know, I wouldn't leave them anywhere because they're rare. Yeah. They're very rare. Yeah. Now that was, he only saw the two of them. He didn't see the others. But there was, I didn't really need any more validation for my own self anyway after that. So it didn't really matter because it wasn't like I was trying to prove it to anybody, it didn't matter to me. It's a constant learning experience with them. So,
So if I may, so the day that you found them, Father guided you to them. So they were a gift from Father, let's say, to you.
But
now it is a gift to many more where you're sharing
stories
about it.
Yeah, and I was being, like I said, I was being a brat too, and he still let me have it. So
that's because you deserve it, Sonja. All the stuff you had to go through.
I thought it could have just disappeared before I even, because I'm sitting there saying, I'm not doing it.
Right.
But you would have to know my whole, I could talk for days and not tell you every little thing that's happened to me, and where I would get so mad at Father and say, I'm not doing it. I am not doing another thing. You're not going to make me tell nobody nothing. I ain't doing it. And the next thing you know, I'm like, hey, I think I need to call you. Yes, I'm kicking my feet and stomping my feet and throwing this fit. And then, I'm like, hey, so you give in because it goes against your human nature it goes against my human nature for somebody to tell me to do something. And usually I'm so hard-headed. It's like you can ask my mama, if you tell me to do something, I'm going to go out of my way to do the opposite. So what better way for Father to teach me to control myself than, Sonja, I need you to do this. And I'm like, not today. But then I turn, I'm like, oh, I got to, you just don't turn your back on that. You might think you're going to. Maybe some people do. I don't know. I can't speak for others. But for me and myself personally, I tried it and it didn't really work out real well for me.
Yeah.
Because then I beat myself up.
Yeah.
Not that anything bad happened to me. It was that I beat myself up because I didn't follow through. You can't lay there in bed at night and not sleep for 3 days because you didn't do what Father asked you to do. Right. Now, you know, whether that's my higher self or that's actually my, you know, there's all the, everybody has their own perception of Father God, and that's totally okay too. You can look at it however you want to. Doesn't really matter. It's that source energy that is communicating with you that, why would you want to cut that off? And I've cut it off before. And it's, I'm trying to watch my mouth. My mouth gets bad sometimes. I watch it, but it sucks. Yeah. It just does. You do it, but then even that in itself is a learning experience. It's, it, you know, and everything is.
Yeah, totally.
I get excited. Sorry. I had to go like,
no,
take a
no, no, it's awesome. Are you kidding? It's so beautiful to see and to witness and to experience that, you know, and have such a beautiful relationship where everybody has the opportunity to have that relationship. Just to connect to that, to Father, you know?
Well, and everyone is an aspect of Source.
Yes.
You know, I was shown when I was in eighth grade, I dropped the, wasn't actually a thermometer, but it was mercury. And how when it hits the floor and it separates in little bitty balls. Yeah. And he was teaching me that day and he said, okay, he was there in the class with me. It was incredible. He said, okay, now look, we call those little balls. He says, now put a face and a personality with a name on each one of them. And so I'm like, okay. He says, but what is it? If I'm this ball, because you could push them all back together and they just kind of meld back together, you know. Right. Well, if you've ever seen Mercury do that, yeah. You can just push it, the little balls, you can push it back together. Yeah. And then he says, okay, that's me. And now let's, if it splatters out, then this is you and this is your sister, and this is your brother, and this is your mom, and this is your daddy, but it's all still me.
Yes.
But yes. With a different personality and a different, so we're all Source, we just don't know it. Yes. I mean, yes. Then you would get into, oh, okay, you're a creator. If God creates, I'm a creator. Yes. So if I'm Source, name Sonja in this body that I'm in right this minute, I am an aspect of Source, which is, to me, is Father God. I just had deja vu like crazy. That was weird. And then it was, then at that point, you know that you don't have to worry about it because anything that happens, you're protected because you're God.
Yeah.
You're Source. And so you can look at it any way you want to be able to wrap your mind around it, because then I promise you each day as you evolve and as you become into more wisdom, what you said 3 weeks ago, you're going to be like, oh, I probably shouldn't have said that, because now you see it differently. But that's totally okay. That's part of your journey.
Yeah.
I used to be afraid to say something because I knew that by next week it might be different. But this today is important because next week is important too.
Yes. Yes.
You don't just go from third grade to graduating, which I mean, in my mind, I kind of did, but I don't, just because I don't remember it. I was actually physically there. I just don't remember it. But yeah, right. This is journey that if we could learn to embody this journey, mm-hmm. and actually not hate it, because when you start waking up, you start hating it because the system looks corrupt, everything looks distorted, and then start pulling. And I have to remind myself of this every single day, pull the cataracts off. I just imagine like I got a thick stack of contacts on, and if I pull them off one at a time, then things start looking differently. Then I see what's on the other side of right now, and it changes my feelings, it changes my perception, it changes the way I feel, and all of a sudden I feel pretty good, you know.
Yeah,
because I went through that of every morning waking up and I'd open my eyes and I would still be here, and I would cry until I would just make myself sick. It was horrible because I just wanted to go home. Well, we're making this our home. So if we're making this our home, where are you going to go to? You know, yeah. if we have integrated, because I know the moment that Father, there was this moment that he said, I'm going to talk to you differently. You won't be coming back here. We're going to talk differently. And I'm going to be in you all the time. And we're going to talk differently. That was a very profound moment. Do you remember that moment, Rick?
I
cried for days. Yes, I cried. I couldn't stop. I was crying hysterically. I said, Father's leaving me. Yeah. He's leaving me. I mean, so that was another moment of waking up. So there's all these different moments of waking up that are so important to your journey when you think, oh, that was just stupid. No, it's not. It's really important because somebody else somewhere on this planet will go through that something similar. And it's, if somebody would have told, if I'd have had somebody when I was younger, I mean, just think of where I would be now. You know, I didn't have that person. I had just Father, which, you mean, you can't beat that. But I didn't really understand it with my human mind, you know.
Right, right.
I would just, you know, click out of here, like Dorothy, click your feet.
But she always had the capability of going home. She just never knew.
That's right. That's
and you're saying the same thing with us.
That's right.
We
that's
have
right.
the capability of going home. We just have to recognize that.
Yes, but home is right here. That's yes. right, because home is right here. It's changing. You have to make that. This is just Sonja's perspective now. Mm-hmm. Not telling anybody what to do, because I know that's a big issue now on all these videos and stuff, but I'm just saying, mm-hmm. from my point of view, where I stand with my experiences and what I can see multidimensionally, I know right here where I sit on the other side of right now is a whole new world. Mm-hmm. And I just have to be able to see it, because you act accordingly to what you see.
Yes. Which really kind of, unless Rick has something to say. Rick, did you want to comment on anything? You looked like you were going to make a comment. No.
I was contemplating. No, great ahead.
Okay. So then that kind of goes into, you know, you talk about we are our own creator, right?
Yeah.
And also.
Because we've been creating by default and we didn't know it. I mean, according to what your DNA, I mean, you think about this too. I mean, this is how I see it. I see my children as an extension of me even. So I can look at my girls and I can see in their lives how they have recreated something that I was already doing, but it's tweaked a little bit. Okay. So I thought, well, if I had more money, I'd do it this way. Well, my oldest daughter has all that and she's doing it that way, but there's still issues there that she's in. You know, it's like, okay, so now she can tweak on her own self. So it's almost like when you can see these things happening in your children's lives and in your extended selves. I mean, I personally have 8. I've got my 3 children and my 5 grandchildren.
Yeah.
I can see myself in each one of them, and I can see how issues will arise. And then I can tell that I've actually made a huge difference in it, because when the same issue arises, but in a different setting, okay, different people, it wasn't as severe as what I thought it was back then. And the whole dynamics of it changed to where it all came out rosy. You know, it all, I mean, where before it was detrimental to me years ago. Mm-hmm. And I saw it manifest in one of my grandchildren. And that in itself was one of the most incredible things I've ever seen, because I knew in that moment that I hadn't completed everything, but I knew that the work that I had done had been successful. And I can say that with every ounce of my being, because that same situation popped up, that same energy popped up with a whole different situation, and the outcome was completely different.
Wow, I love that.
Yeah. So that's, yeah, and maybe other people don't manifest it in that way. They could see it with their workers, or they could see it with this person or that person. But in my world, that's where I look at my what's happening. That's how I gauge it.
Yeah. Well, and something else you talked about too, you know, hating the journey, you know. You know, we talk about, we just want to get the heck out of here. Or we just don't, you know, the journey that we've on that has been, you know. So let's talk about that, hating the journey, because you had mentioned that. So, and I wrote that down. So I feel that it's something maybe we can share about that.
Oh, yeah. I've had many days. I mean, Rick could even testify to that. I mean, there was a moment like, get me out of here.
Yeah.
You know, you're standing outside wanting a ship to pick you up. You don't even care what's in the dang thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, just anything, because it seems so it's like, what do I even do with myself? Because once you start waking up, you can't go backwards. There is no going backwards. It just don't happen. You're on this journey to start changing things.
Yeah.
And I think that's what this planet is all about. It's an incredible place that you learn how to create, what not to create, what you want to create. And I mean, who's going to give you the reins if you can't create properly? You got to learn it. I mean, it's part of it. And if we just don't remember, that's why we came here. You know, we think, oh, somebody's trying to get us, or, oh, they're doing this. As long as you're pointing the finger at somebody else. But I don't know if I can say what I said earlier on here, but as long as you're pointing the finger at somebody else or buying toilet paper, you're not there yet.
Exactly. That's right.
I mean, it's like, look at yourself, look in the mirror and be okay with it.
Yeah.
You know, I can trigger somebody in a heartbeat. I can trigger my middle daughter. I can trigger her. And then by the end of the conversation, she's like, oh, I have some work to do, don't I? I'm like, yeah. Said, I do too. I said, I do too. But I can sit here and tell you I do too. But if you can't see it, how can you change it?
Yeah.
If you can't see it,
yeah.
You got to own it. You got to take care of your business. You got to do your work. And if you don't know how to do your work, Google it. There's a million people out there talking about how to do your work. Try it. Try the different ways. See what works for you. Or just listen and let Source tell you how to do it that'll work for you even better without asking somebody else. You don't have to have anybody else do your work for you. Mm-hmm. It's. I know it sounds so simple. I know there's somebody going, it ain't that easy. I can feel somebody saying that right now. It's not that easy.
Well, you yourself.
It really... I mean, yeah, no, it's not easy. It's kind of like, okay, you ever been in one of those moods where you just didn't want to wash your hair as a woman?
Yeah.
I mean, I hate to wash my hair. Yeah. I just do.
Yeah.
I don't want to have to dry it. I don't want to I have this nappy curly hair. I don't want to have to fix it. And you know, I don't really go that many places. So a lot of times I don't, but then I think I've got to wash my hair today. And that sounds hideous.
Yeah.
But what do? You make yourself go wash your hair.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, something is so little and minute as that, you can apply that to do your inner work.
Yeah.
Don't wait for somebody else. If you don't take care of yourself, you've got to take care of yourself because nobody else is going to. It's not about that, or you wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's a planet somewhere where they all do it for you, but that's not what happens here on Earth.
Not from what I've experienced.
No, there's nobody doing my work for me. I mean, yeah, you can get people to assist you. I have some amazing friends that I can talk to. Make friends. Mm-hmm. Ask questions. You will connect with somebody, I promise you. I mean, just like Rick. Rick lives in Canada. I live in Texas. Mm-hmm. I mean, what are the odds? I mean, he has been my friend that I know that no matter what I say, it's okay.
Yeah.
I can cuss, I can scream, I can cry. And at the end of the conversation, he's like, Sonja. Now listen, you know, my friend Deborah, I mean, the same thing, my friend Michelle. It's like these people will come to you when you put your intention that you need a friend.
Yeah.
You need somebody to vent to. You're not, nobody is by themselves. Well, that's one thing for sure.
Yeah. So true.
Yeah, I love that. It's like a seesaw. You know, you get on the playground, you're going to find somebody to play with.
Yeah.
And if nobody wants to play with you, why? Why don't they want to play with you? You know, that's what I tell my granddaughter. She's nobody wants to play with me. I'm like, why? Mm-hmm. Why don't they want to play with you? Why are you saying that nobody wants to play with you? You got to figure that out.
Yeah.
If you were somebody else, why wouldn't you want to play with you?
Right.
You know, I mean.
Yeah. And don't you think we create that, though? Because we're creators.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, if that's our life.
We're creating it so we can learn it. So if you come across somebody somewhere down the line, somewhere else, and you can tell them. So it's like kind of like an interwoven knowledge of in this whole little, you know, they talk about the matrix being this or that. In my mind's eye, the matrix is this interwoven blanket of knowledge that just you're walking through this path and it is going somewhere and you're meeting people and you're running into, I mean, some of the experiences of just meeting someone else can totally change your life.
Yes.
Because of what they've, what's happened before they met you, and then what happened to you that you can connect on. And then when you leave there, you have shared transmissions, and then you go out, you know, it's kind of like your backpack gets a little bit fuller and you go out there and do a little bit more. Oh, I just had a revelation about that. But that, Rick, do you remember that, dragonfly with the eyes?
Yeah. You took the pictures of that. Yes.
Yeah. I've never shown you that one. It had these, the eyes on it looked fake.
Really?
It looked like the eyes on a, like a doll or something. Those little roll around eyes, mm-hmm. those little things stick on the eyes. And this thing had a backpack on it. Well, forever I thought, oh, it's the government watching me, or it's this, or it's that. And I just now, when I was saying that, just got, that's that backpack. My eyes are wide open. That was me. With my backpack, and my eyes are wide open looking for somebody to connect to, so I can figure out if there's somebody that's a little ahead of me, or if I need to go over here and call this person or that person. And, you know, it doesn't always happen, but somewhere down this line, it may not be on the time that you think it's going to be on, but all of a sudden, you've hit that moment and you've gotten that information. You're like, woohoo, your backpack's a little bit fuller. And this little dragonfly had a backpack on it. So I just realized what that was.
Oh my gosh.
Sorry about that. I got excited because I just it kind of like hit me.
That's great. I love it.
Yeah. The perspectives, you know, can change quite a bit on that and on things like that. Yeah.
Yes.
It's so great to hear. You know, Sonja, what I wish to share also with the viewers, on the diamonds, what I had remembered when Sonja shared the story with me, I had shared it with others,
mm-hmm.
a story that Sonja had told me that I had remembered about the whole fiasco. Or a scenario with the diamonds. But what I am seeing here today, which is totally interesting, is that Sonja's story today and what I remember her telling me before are slightly different. They're two different stories, but I remember both of them.
Wow. That's incredible.
It's totally interesting. Yeah, the first is, I don't know if we talked very much about it, Linda, but I know I see Colleen on here and a couple I'd shared the story with prior. And the story that I shared about Sonja finding them and different things with it are different. And
wow.
And what was amazing for me, sitting back here and hearing Sonja tell her story today, that it was different. But I remembered it. As she said it, I remembered it as well. So,
right. So see, there's infinite possibilities that things change. Is kind of like the Mandela effect.
Yeah.
You know, you still remember that before, but now you see it like it is here. So things can change. And hey, what, think about this. This to me, this is a great point. How many times has somebody called somebody else a liar?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And all the whole time they were both speaking truth, but their perceptions were completely different.
Yes.
Yeah, that as well. Yeah. And
I mean, people have been accused of things that they weren't even in the area. I mean, and because their consciousness was somewhere else. You know, when you start getting into this, boy, do you get some expanding in the mind.
Love it. Love it.
Yeah.
Rick, were you going to say something?
I was just going to say, sometimes when I put messages out as well, you know, I try to put them as clear and as blunt, you know, as I can, right to the point. But what I will find is that I will find sometimes later when I do look at some of the comments, there are ones that will ask the very question that I explicitly put out into the post. And so, you know, you could look at that as a same sort of a thing, what we're speaking about, Sonja. But
yes,
it's very interesting. Yeah, the perspective. And just the other day, Helen, a good friend of mine, she said, Rick, she said, people do not hear sometimes what I am saying. She said, I will say something, and if we're in a conversation, and they will just get on something that is not in line with what they just said, it will become all distorted or what have you. So again, it's very interesting with the different perspectives. But I'm very intrigued, Sonja, with what I just shared, about both stories are heard, but both are correct.
Yeah. What was the main difference in the stories that you remember?
Oh, okay. The main difference is that the way that I remembered it is that you had come home from the dentist and that there were two diamonds in front of your truck. Well, the story, the way I remembered it, was that you had come home, got out of your truck, and Father had told you to stop, and you stopped, and then he told you to go to the front of the truck, which you did, and you said, now what? Then he told you to look down, and in your driveway were two of the diamonds there. So it was very interesting where you said it was at, you know, a dentist place. So also with this, what I had remembered was that in the first story that I remembered, you know, the first perspective, that at that time I did not, let's say, remember you saying about the dentist, but when you brought the dentist up today, then yes, that was connected back to the original story. So what I'm saying is that there's interesting things what I'm experiencing here with two different, slightly different perspectives of it, which is very interesting, which I'll look at later. So it's something about, as we said, different timelines, yes, different dimensions with it. So it's very interesting, that aspect.
Well, you know something too, on the story of the CERN thing, it was kind of the same thing on my end when you were telling that story. And I remember you running into the guy and he said that, and you went back to the computer and you looked it up. But I don't remember it being 2 months later. But I do remember being 2 months later. So it's like I remember both versions. So I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
So it's very interesting how we're being shown this today.
Yeah. Well, doesn't it kind of go back? Oh, go ahead, Greg.
No, what I was just going to say, yeah, he had told me that in August. So, you know what I should do with that? I believe it was, no, it might have only been a month later, Sonja. Yeah, a month, or maybe a month and a week or so. So it may.
Right. Yeah, but on, I also remember it not being, but just, you know, a week later. So that's whether it was a month or 2 months. It. I'm talking about, you know, quite a bit of a difference there that I do remember both versions, which this is really incredible. This is the first time I've ever noticed it when you just pointed that out, that I do remember both versions.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's really something that we're starting. Okay. This is something new. This is something new. I've tried to alter my, you know, thinking, well, maybe you just messed up on time, because time is really hard for me. I get confused with time really quickly because I will, you know, I shift or whatever, and I'll think, what? It's already this time. And, you know, and people take that like they don't think anything about it. But when you really start paying attention to your surroundings and see what you're manifesting, you will be in shock at what you can do.
Yeah.
Or what you're doing to show you something, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, something I wrote down was there's no time and space where you're shifting, right? So it wouldn't even be where we're altering realities, I guess. I don't know if that's what I want to call it.
Well, I don't, you know, I used to say that, Linda, I did. Okay. I used to say there's no time and space, but I guess it was about, I don't know how long ago it was, but all of a sudden I was somewhere else, okay? And while I was somewhere else, I knew that I only had a short period of time that I had left myself a message somewhere, okay? So I'm running through this house that I lived in, which was not in this house, but I knew that I was in another dimension. Mm-hmm. And my sister was there, and she was crying because they thought that I had gone crazy there. And my husband was telling her, oh, she's just having another one of her spells. And I was trying to get away from them to get in my sewing room, which I had I sew now, and I have a sewing room there too. So it was all these similarities. And I was where I had my stack of notes. And so I was trying to get to that because I knew I only had a short period of time before I was going to shift back into this body, which I never, I mean, okay, so if I back that up to when I was a kid, and father would be like, it's time for you to go back. You know, I'd cry and I would try to procrastinate. But when it was time to go, I mean, boom, I was gone. Mm-hmm. So that just now popped up to me too. That's pretty important as well, because that's been shown to me over and over and over that in this time, that maybe time is what holds these, that, okay, let's put it, if I want to put it like this, this space that I'm in right now has a certain amount of time in it, but this space over here has a certain amount of time in it too. So the time there and the time here is different.
Right.
Okay. Because I can tell I can be there for a certain period of time and come back here and nothing really has changed here. And it feels like I've been there for, you know, 3 days and I've lived out 3 days there, but it was only 15 minutes here.
Right.
So it's like in this other spaces, and I guess it's according to how the earth is rotating and it's the physics of it as to where these dimensions actually are that I can shift into. But that was really something, because I knew that I could feel the time and I could feel that only had, and I was trying to make them leave me alone, because it would just be like this reality right here. If my sister's crying saying, you know, you need to try to act normal, and, you know, there's something wrong with you. And in this reality here, she knows as much as I do. You know, both of my sisters are just, you know, they see some of the same stuff I do now. So it's kind of like that wouldn't happen here now like it was happening there. There she was totally asleep. They thought I had lost my mind. They were calling it spells because I was shifting in and out. But I had left myself notes there. And I don't know. Right as I walked into the room, I shifted out. Mm. I don't remember. And I haven't been back there that I can consciously remember. So I don't know if I actually grabbed their notes or not. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I never saw any more of it to find out. Because I'm telling you, I was on a mission to get in that bedroom. And they kept like petting on me and trying to hug on me and stuff. And I'm like, y'all got to go. I got to run in here. And I was running. And right as I get to the door, boom, I was out of there. Oh, so it kind of reminds me of that show with Hugh Jackman and Meg Ryan. What's the name of that one? You know what I'm talking about? But they actually used an outside portal there by the bridge. Oh gosh, I'll think of it in a minute. It's really a good one because it really kind of shows you.
Oh, I say I love Hugh Jackman. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I do too.
It shows you that we can transport.
Yes. Yes.
If I may.
Of course you may.
Yes.
Okay. Sonja, yeah, I just received what's happening with our different perspectives we had there. We have to remember our multi-dimensionality, but also our bilocation. That, and I had referred to this, I had received this and put it out in an update several months ago as well, that we can be on more than one timeline at once. So having said that, this fully explains what is occurring, Sonja, because we don't really, especially you and I, Sonja, and others, as we know, we are seen in more places than one. You know, for example, several years ago, I was in Alberta, and my family calls me up and says the brother-in-law is talking with me in Nova Scotia. And said, you know, they're kind of accusing me, you're not in Alberta, you're here in Nova Scotia. But
right, right, exactly.
Same sort of thing. So this is, you know, this is why this is also occurring. And also, I know that not only that, that, you know, during the astral, you're also in other places, but not only that, we are able to project, let's say, our image, because I do this as well. So you can project your image and be in multiple locations at once, to keep it simple. But this has to do with, yeah, I'll just say that for now.
Well, yeah, because the way I see it, there's all these different versions of me. Even the different versions of me from the time I got out of bed this morning until the time I am sitting here right now. And all these different versions of me, you know, now those are just memories. But it's an imprint. It's actually a, you know, it's a projected imprint that in that moment. So if you could... You know, if you can learn how to maneuver through those moments, and, you know, even if you go back through your memory and you look there, and then, but I've actually gone to those memories and like there I was again. So there's more to it that I haven't fully experienced yet, but I know I will because I've experienced parts of it. So I know that right now, on another timeline, I just graduated high school. I know this for a fact. I'm 18 years old.
Wow.
I mean, and nobody anywhere could tell me any different. I was in that body 3 days ago, and I looked in the mirror. I always make myself look in the mirror to see what I look like. And I always had blonde hair. You know, all my life I had curly blonde hair. Well, as I've gotten older, it's gotten darker. So now it's, you know, it's probably your length, Linda, and it's darker now. I quit, you know, I got sick of, you know, keep trying to keep it blonde. You know how you do, you get dirty blonde and then yeah. Yeah, it does. And I got sick of doing that. So I just let it go dark. And of course I got a little bit of gray, but anyhow, in this, when I looked in the mirror, my hair was dark and straight. It wasn't curly.
Wow.
So that was a different version of me. And the crazy thing is over the past 3 days, I can kind of, I'll be walking through the house doing something or playing with the kids or something. And all of a sudden I'm in that body for a few seconds. I can feel it. And I don't know why this one in particular keeps coming up, but I will know, I will give myself the information because I always do.
Right.
You know, it's not like it's something I could ask somebody else.
Right.
It's something that I have to wait for it to manifest. And sometimes on these different dimensions, it takes a minute, you know, and as humans, we're impatient beings. We want it right now.
Convenient.
That's right.
Now.
That's right. We don't want to have to go through this. We want somebody to do it for us. Get out that magic wand and whip me up a new reality. What's wrong with y'all? You know, it don't work that way.
That's right. And really, I wish it did.
Well, we say that, but when you get into this higher, and I've been there with you. I'm like, oh, screw this. I hate this. It's horrible. But when I started realizing that no matter, even if it's something hideous that puts itself in front of your face, and I've recently had this happen to me, something that was the most hideous thing that you could possibly, you know, for a mother, something happened to one of your children, and it happened right in front of my face, and I thought, immediately I thought I was being attacked. I did not realize until the very end of it, which was yesterday, that it had finally come to a close, that what had actually taken place, how it had manifested down, skipped a generation out. I mean, actually I could go back one way and another, the DNA or the RNA, the whole, I mean, the whole bag, bag was full, and I watched it play out in a way, and it turned out I felt like I had chains were knocked off of me. I'm not kidding you. Really? This is something that I had experienced when I was a child, and then I saw it manifest out, and I saw how it all started changing and morphing in different directions. And when it came to a final end, it was completely, it's over. I had my friend with me in the truck, and I was going, oh, happy day. I can't sing, but I was so excited because I knew in that moment that I had been successful at the buck stops here. That stops here. That might have come down this lineage for generations and generations and generations, but us together, we stopped it right here today. In that moment, I knew it was over.
Well, what's the question I want to ask? How did you know that it was?
You have to pay attention. You have to start looking at, okay, so let me see if I can find a good example without just spilling all my guts here, because it's kind of a personal thing. I know what you mean. You kind of need a little bit more juicy juice on that. So if I said, okay, let me think of an example. Any other time I could just spit one out, but it's kind of like, okay, so if you start seeing a pattern, look for the patterns in something. When you can start seeing the patterns, because everyday life is not just everyday life. You'll start seeing it on the TV. You'll start seeing it in your dog's behavior. You'll start seeing it in the way the grass grows. You'll start seeing it in the clouds. You'll start seeing it in the way your vehicle drives. You'll start seeing, look for the patterns. When you start seeing the patterns, I just make a mental note of, I used to write it down, but I have so many journals. It's just, I got sick of writing it down. I got sick of taking pictures. I've done this forever. You know, you get sick of doing it. You get sick of looking at it. Then you get to where you don't have to write it down no more. Then you get to where you're like, oh, it kind of like connects the dots. The dots start connecting. You're like, oh, that same thing happened to me. Then it happened to grandma. Then it happened to, you know, so they told me about this story a long time ago. And then you see it, how it's manifested down the generations. I mean, we're talking about abundance. We're talking about illness. We're talking about anything that you can think of. And then once you start working on that, but in that moment, when you've put the puzzle pieces together and you realize what that actually was, what that sickness was, what this thing was, where it looks like you're being attacked, or what this was, you know, somebody runs into your car, or they run over your dog, or, you know, something hideous happens, and you realize there's this moment that no one can tell you any different. You know from the depths of your soul that you just finished, you just completed that thread that had all that crap on it. It's like the osmosis system is working, everybody. It's like, right? Elvis is in the building. It is working. You know, there's this moment that I felt like I could fly.
Yeah.
It was that much of a release.
Now, why do you think it surfaced? Like, why would it have come up at this time? Is there a certain, you know, is it because of the times that we're in?
I think so. Okay. I think that we, well, and I constantly work on myself. Now, okay. I think from my personal experience, you can escalate your experience. I do. Yeah. I have escalated it, but what'll happen when you do, you hit a brick wall and you kind of have to wait because Earth is, you know, Gaia is going to she's going through a transition and you can't go any faster than the planet that you're riding. Yes. So you can go as fast as you want to. You can be that racehorse, but you got to sit there and tap your foot waiting on others. And I think that happens to a lot of people. They don't even know they're doing it. They don't realize why they're miserable. Well, yeah, we kind of got ahead of ourselves and now we're kind of bored waiting on everybody else. We didn't pace ourselves. That's like with anything. If you're at the dinner table and you eat all your food real fast, you're waiting on everybody else finishing.
Exactly. Good analogy. I mean,
yeah, we have examples right in front of our face every single day and we take it as that's the norm. Oh, that's just normal. No, there is no normal except the setting on the dryer. Anything else is not normal, and you need to really, I mean, I have to give that credit to my friend. She always said that, but I saved it. But there is nothing in front of you that you cannot dissect and look at. So why would you ever get bored when you can just start dissecting the way the pillows are on the couch if you want to? You know, if you don't have to, but you'll learn something.
Yeah.
From every single thing that you do, every ache and pain you have, everything, you'll learn something. Now that, I feel like I got carried away.
No, it was great. And I feel Rick is wanting to say something to all this as well. Rick?
If I may, I'd like to go back.
Thank you.
I'd like to go back to the perspective where I was saying that I had two different memories of the story, you know, about the diamonds, and both are correct. But, and also what we said back there is that we can access multiple timelines, but we can also split ourselves to be on different timelines. And the reason I wish to bring this up is because of what I am told to teach is for everyone, you know, to keep their vibration the highest, because then you can sustain yourself on the highest timeline. And now where this is for what we call the quantum financial system, you know, the energetic system where you're up in the universal flow. Mm-hmm. So again, it's showing you what Sonja and I just represented with both of us having two different memories on different stories. It's actually two different timelines as well. Now, the trick is, though, is getting control over your multi-dimensional abilities that you just stay in the top highest timeline, and then you can experience also more of the magic. But so I wanted to bring that up again because it's all right on theme with what's presently occurring throughout the collective, because the way it always works, you are introduced to these sort of things and then we're given the information usually shortly after of what actually occurred, but it's information so that we can navigate to the next levels of the ascension, which is very good. So I've been receiving, since you've been speaking, Sonja, you know exactly what occurred there. So there are many, I'm receiving new information to orient it and coordinate it and adjust it into more information for the masses. So this is, you know, just so beautiful that we had this interview today, because, you know, not only the magnificence of what you shared about the diamonds, but also because of this important aspect that I'm currently speaking of. And also I will share with you too, Sonja, when you were speaking about, I'm jumping in timelines here, but you were just speaking a little bit ago about when you were 18 or what have you, right at that time, there was a massive deja vu that I had right here, like for those couple moments with it,
mm-hmm.
indicating again, when you have deja vu, you are actually, deja vu is the same sort of thing as the different perspectives, because you're in two places at once. So
mm-hmm.
the deja vu again was remembering it exactly as it had occurred some other time, but without getting too much in this, we'll need to perhaps do another show on these sort of things.
Yeah.
But it is all tied in and linked to our multi-dimensional ability. But again, right in this time, we're waiting for that access, which is, I'm given, it's already here, that we can access that QFS timeline, which is going to be here. And what I'll need to do, as I see, is that I'll need to begin putting out more information to get the others in tune, how to slip in and to access the QFS timeline, where we go to receive the funding we temporarily need while we're here. So this is a very significant, so I thank you so much for that share, Sonja. Because of this, what I'm sharing with you all, I am receiving the downloads and more information that I can more so assist in facilitating and coordinating those into the QFS timeline as well. So I'll just stop there.
Well, that's incredible. Yeah. Because, you know, I was speaking with someone earlier, and that was, you know, that seems to be an issue across the board. You know, the more you wake up, the broker you get. I mean, if people are just, you know, divine individuals just seem to be, they're losing things. I mean, I've been a millionaire and I've been broke as a dog. And it's kind of like, when it starts, you just cannot insert yourself into the system. You can try, but it is so hard. It you know, you just don't know what every day is going to hold. And there's some mornings I need to lay back down. You know, these energy waves, and we're moving through them. It's hard on the physical body. It's hard on the, you know, sometimes you just, or there's days where I can sit in my chair and I travel all day long. And then, you know, I'll call my friend and say, you're not going to believe where I went today. You know, so it's crazy that, you know, I know for a fact in my own self, my own personal facts, I know that we can shift into this space where that is possible. What you're talking about, Rick, I know it. I know where it's at. I just don't know how to get there and stay there, you know, mm-hmm. and I know that's part of this awakening process, that as we become more enhanced, we're able to stay longer. Cause just like back in that one in particular that I brought up, I knew my time there was limited of my consciousness being in that body. And I know that those other bodies are there. I've seen them too. Mm-hmm. I've been in them for a brief moment, but I couldn't stick. I couldn't stay there. I had to come back here until I got a little bit stronger and a little bit stronger and a little bit stronger. So I know that it's what you're saying, Rick. I know it's true. I know it's true.
Yeah.
I've seen it. I love it.
I love to share with you. It was comical a few nights ago. I picked up a lady and, with the consciousness, and took her for a dragon ride and went way out in what you would call space. And what was very comical is that I was going to go in hyperspace with the consciousness to transcend time very quickly. All of a sudden, Father said, no, go back. And so there was more to it, but it was very interesting. He said no. And also what I shared, I believe, in a past interview, Linda, you know, I tried to leave her several years ago, and Sonja knows this.
Get me out of here.
Sort of my, you know, in my physical vessel, but I laid on my bed in my camper, and I had raised myself, my energy, you know, a couple feet above my body, and could see my body laying there, you know, everything perfectly. I had detached my energetic field, my consciousness, and I was going, and I was about 2.5 feet above my body, going in my energetic form. All of a sudden, on my energetic form, where the small of my back would be, whoomp, a big boot come down, push me back in my body. And, my eyes snap open, and I say, WTF. Yeah. Father's words inside of my head come, I insist you stay to watch the show. And he was stern, and but it was so comical, you know, with that. But what I'm saying that is because Sonja has that ability. When she said, you know, she would go and visit Father, and and go and visit all these other places as well. And yeah, it's very real, and we can do it. But you know, Sonja, Daddy keeps me here for the short time anyway. I can do it, yes. And so I'm just sharing with the viewers that that yeah, you can do it, and I know how to do it, and I can share that as well when the time is right. But instead of sharing how to go all the way back to source, we have to do this incrementally, that I'll share the ways up, you know, to the next higher timelines where things are alleviated for others. And we're right at that threshold right now, you know, Linda, what what we said when you know, Father said it's close at hand, you know, in our discussions as well. So we're very close without putting a time frame on it, because I never really do that unless I'm told from, you know, Father to put a date on things. However, you know, again, this QFS system that we can access through our multidimensional abilities. The Father is saying that, you know, it's really, it's here now for us. We just need to make that connection, meaning that the reset of currencies, it is an actual timeline that we can put ourselves into here, even if it does not occur on the present timeline out with you or out around you. We still can access the other timeline, and we can jump back and forth. We can come back to this timeline, let's say fueled up and cashed up or what have you, and perform our divine duties is what I'm given. This whole ascension thing is happening, yeah, for a very important reason, and there is a certain way that it goes. Nothing is by chance. What has been occurring.
Absolutely awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that, Rick. It's so important.
You know, I think, okay, so something came to me while you were saying that, and you know, as creators, you know, we're creating with our subconscious minds constantly, and a lot of it, when these things happen, we, you know, we think it's by default, you know, people call it by default, but then you learn something from it. So you can take something and turn it into something for yourself because you know yourself did that. But if I look at, like, when he's talking about this other timeline, I know it's there too. Okay. So then I think, well, so we started creating this. So consciously we knew that we needed this space to go to. So we all created this as a mass collective, you know, that a whole timeline that, yes. you know, you would, that's a lot of space, you yeah. know?
And okay. Here, so this is where the trick lies as well. Thank you, Sonja. If I may.
Yes. Yeah, so that is, we've already created that. So, I see you girl, y'all, I see. This is when I probably should have figured out how to put my video on because I've got little blinking lights all in my house. Yeah, so yes, all of a sudden they just like showed up everywhere. But so anyhow, I know that we've created a space to jump to. Okay, yeah. So if we're constantly, and I know for a fact that I have shifted into so many different bodies because the difference in my nose, the difference in things that, you know, you can gain weight or lose weight, but you can't really get too much taller or shorter. You know, that's not a normal thing for a human to do. But let me tell you something. My feet will get bigger. My feet will get smaller. My uh-huh. nose looks one way, and then all of a sudden looks another way. And I can pull out pictures to show you the difference in myself where I'm shifting. And it's not just age. Look for the – if you pull out your picture, start looking – for orbs in your pictures that you never saw before, they'll just be there now. And then you can start looking for differences in your nose and you know, certain things about yourself that you know doesn't just happen with age. And that's how you know that you're...
I'm sorry. Huh? I can put you on video.
No, that's okay.
Okay.
No,
okay.
I was just... Yeah.
Okay. So if I may
interrupt
again,
you, though. Again,
So Sonja, yeah, what you got on to, see, the trick is, like, as Sonja said, creating our realities. We can do that on an individual basis, or we can do it on a collective, unified basis. So this is why it's also so important for the creators, the ones that know they are creating, that are familiar with that aspect of themselves. We get everyone, you know, thinking and creating that 5D quantum financial system, then it brings it into play. So we are much stronger together than what we are individually. There are some of us individually that can access it, but what we wish to do is bring more and more into it. Then we bring that fully and lock it into this reality. So one of the keys, again, is to get everyone onto the same lines of, you know, the good things. And we don't wish for others to be distracted and thinking about politics and all of this. Because we are the creator group that creates again what we wish to see. And if we keep stalling and focusing on politics and mundane, well, you're distracted looking at this, and this is not being created. But right at this point, we can create this in a day and be there. Why not focus on the good for everyone, you know, instead of focusing on them?
Well, think about this. In a multi-dimensional world, I mean, we're talking about multi-dimensional universes, okay? If something's not working here, I mean, you think of what it would take to truly change this system here. I mean, truly change it.
Blink of an eye could change it.
But listen, let me finish. Let me finish. I'm going a direction with this. If you take your focus and you focus it on the government, what happens? All your energy's going toward the government. Now, whatever state of mind you're in, that's the energy that's going. So it looks chaotic. Yes. It looks like a cluster. Okay. Yes. But if you focus on creating a new and wonderful place right here, right now, right where you're sitting, which is for the collective, Okay. You do it on, you know, if everybody was focusing on that instead of what we're creating this new space to jump to. We're all jumpers. You just don't know that you're a jumper. You don't know that you're jumping time because you haven't seen, you haven't noticed it yet. Start looking for it. That's what we do. So if you have a place to jump to, because that's kind of like the Mandela effect. Once you jump, something else changes because energy cannot be killed, but it can just change forms. So it's just changing. It's just changing the space, but yet you're creating. Am I making sense? I kind of got off track a little bit. It's like you jump. You can go to this new space. I mean, think of what it would take versus doing it, putting your energy, try a different direction is all I'm trying to say. Try to focus on it a little bit different direction.
Yeah, then instead of focusing on the government or whatever, focusing on where you're at in the space right now.
Right, with the space that you're at right now. And because the more that you, and what this, what we need as a whole, okay? So what Rick is saying, I'm agreeing with what he's saying. It doesn't sound like it, but I am. I'm agreeing with what he's saying. But what I'm saying is, this space that has already been created that we've all actually been working on truly exists. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if you work on yourself, then you end up there. It ends up where you're at. It ends up, it's kind of hard to wrap your mind around. You're there, but you're here. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Cause energetically you're there. Yeah. Cause we're all energetic beings.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. I think I said that right. I don't know.
Yeah. I got you.
I mean, in a blink of things can be changing. When Rick said in a blink of an eye, it kind of threw me off of what I was going to say because I thought, well, yeah, you're right about that too. So it kind of like it's according to where you're at, what actually works because they both work. It's just where you're at, how you want to do it. It work. Both of them actually work.
Yeah. I think that's key is paying attention to what is your present thought right here, right now.
Right.
And where you're directing that to, because of the saying of where your focus is, where your attention goes, energy flows.
That's right. So what better place to start than to start on yourself?
Absolutely.
And then what would be good for anyone around you?
Yes.
And then what would be good for your family in a community? And then what would be good for the community in a state, in a town, and then in a state? And then, you know, so instead of just jumping on the government, go back and take the staircase and clear yourself as you're going, because you don't want to just jump up there being illiterate. You know, you don't want to, well, you would never want to just get up there and face the nation being dumb. You know, I wouldn't want to personally. So it's kind of like tend to your business, tend to your own business, and then start branching out and looking at the other stuff. And it really doesn't take that long. You can do it in a day. I mean, I started clearing my family's just so I could go back. Went down my mama's side, went down my daddy's side, and I cleared for 2 days. Rick probably remembers this. And those little things still pop up, but nothing like what it probably would have if I hadn't have done the work. And all you have to do is look at it and change it in your mind. Just change it. Just look at it and change it. Look at it and change it. It's not that hard. People make a bigger, they make it, they think that it's bigger, because I remember being there thinking that, oh, that was going to be really hard, but it really wasn't.
Wow.
It was easy, because we are creators. We can do these things. You have to give yourself the credit.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Rick, did you want to say, did you have something you were going to comment?
Oh, no, I'm great. Thank you.
Okay. So that kind of goes in, if you want to talk, I know we were going to talk about the flow and not pushing against it. So we're kind of tapping into that a little bit.
Yeah, I think we kind of already touched on that. It's kind of like just, you know, you have this inner guidance that even though it looks different than what some people around you is doing, it doesn't, you know, you go with that inner guidance flow. That river's getting bigger and bigger daily. There's more and more people that are, you know, not just following the herd, You know, they're becoming more than just, you know, following somebody and not looking up. They're looking up and they're paying attention.
Right.
So.
Well, is there anything else that you wanted to share for the viewers and the listeners that'll be tuning in afterwards?
Not that I can think of. I'm still thinking about, I didn't say that right a while ago. Rick, did I say it wrong? I kind of got off track on that.
Sonja,
I feel like there's still perfect. A little bit in the air right there.
No, everything's perfect, it's, you know, yeah. For everyone. But again, to speak my full truth here, for the mission that I have, at least, is to excel everyone forward and create things going forward. So
yes,
what I wish to do is, you know, have what I, there is a difference. There are many that are at different levels among in our collective, our Christ collective. There are ones that are just entering it, becoming familiar with their gifts, but there are also very powerful ones like you, Sonja, that when we are this powerful of creators that we can create things very quickly for others to adjust into very rapidly. So again, having said that, what I had wished to do was just take all of us above all of the rigmarole, or, you know, everything with politics.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I totally agree.
But Father's telling me it's a transitional process, which mm-hmm. I have to speak my truth. I just wanted to get out of here because I know that money is ridiculous and things. But nevertheless, Father tells me we have to do this bit by bit. So that is being done that way. And my intents and purposes as being here is awakening the others to their greatest potential and keep going forward with the strongest ones as far as we can take it, because we build it and they must come, they must follow. But without yes. heaven, the ones going forward, you have nothing. They're all down here where they can't see anything. You need them above so that they can look at the big picture.
Yeah. I totally agree.
Yeah.
Agree with that. I think that there's, if there's someone that's already experienced it, they open up a door way for others to go there. And I know there's, you know, things that Rick has taught me, things that my other friends that they've experienced. And once they've introduced that to me, then, you know, even with all the experiences I had, it was just amazing some of the things that I could now experience since they experienced that in their body. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's like once one does it, it opens it up.
Indeed.
So,
yes.
The 100th monkey effect.
And it's all shared. Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely correct. You know,
and it's accessible.
Yes.
One of the most amazing newest things is the dragon energy that we integrated, and that rapidly awakened. You know, some already had it integrated through the Christ Collective, but what I was able to witness was new ones just becoming familiar with what a dragon energy was, but seeing them being integrated with it as well. And, you know, just confirmation after confirmation with that. So,
well, that yeah. energy is incredible. The first time that I ever experienced it was with you, Rick.
Yeah.
You got bit by that spider, and I was sitting on the back porch and had no idea. And when all of a sudden I felt this rush, and I was in dragon form, and I was flying to Canada. And the next thing you know, I was there around his camper, and I could see I was remote viewing. I could see this stray dog. I could see these women. I could see, you know, these Cather campers and stuff. And then, you know, he felt my presence there, but I got there through dragon energy, and I felt so strong that I felt this weird energy out there that was, you know, I didn't know what it was. I just started, you know, burning it.
Yep. And
go, girl. I love it. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, if I may, my perspective here, like, you know, Sonja, I was bit by, it was an interdimensional spider. My whole face was all swollen. One eye, rig two, and I only had about a quarter of vision out of one eye. And nevertheless, this, you know, Sonja, she said, I'm going to come and try to heal you. And she said, I'm using my dragon. And this was actually my first introduction to dragon energy. What occurred is that she said that, and I had my eyes closed laying in the bed, and before she even said it, I could sense something coming. And with my eyes closed, all I could see was this dark green, huge energy and feel it. And I knew it was with Sonja, and, you know, it was I knew what it was exactly, and it was no denying it. It was actually there, and I could see it. But also, you know, Sonja, before that, as she's saying, she came with her dragon, but there was a white dog there that she didn't know about. She described that in the road pretty well where I was at, because she was asking which camper, but she knew right where to go anyway. That's so awesome.
And again, that was incredible.
Wow. Yeah, it was no, you know, her abilities are fully accurate, and just totally amazing. Yeah, and then poof, the energy is all there over me. And I believe very rapidly, yeah, I began to heal from that as well. I will also say that at that time too, I believe on Facebook, Sonja, you or some others had also, there was another group that was sending healing, and I,
yes, that was before I got off of social media. I had I was in a group that did it's a group of really powerful people, and I just put on there that, you know, we're taking the train to Rick. You know, we gotta head that direction.
But,
and so it was a big difference.
Not to degrade the healing group, because I did see their energies there as well, like it was pink and green and yellow. And but like when Sonja just come in, she was just like like push them
full force.
Like, so if you want to look at size, you know, yeah. I could, this healing group that was assisting me was like about that big, but when Sonja come in, she's as big as what's behind me here on the wall. And just huge. It was comical in that respect as well. But you know, actually, I had my eyes closed, but I see energy and sense it in different ways, and I see the colors of energy, and just no mistaking it. But when she come in there, yeah, just all encompassing, like she just come in and just put huge dragon wings right down over me, like it was just so cool.
Wow. That's so beautiful.
Yes. Well, that was a poison. It was some kind of weird poisonous spider, and his face was, I mean, it was bad. Wow. It, you know, I was worried. So I think a lot of times too, you kind of, when you have this heartfelt intention, you can, it's kind of like the adrenaline. You just, you're like, oh no, yeah. I'm not letting him, this ain't happening. No. And you just, you're like, whoosh. Yeah. You know, like if you see those people with, you know, cars falling on their kids and they're able to pick the car up, yeah, or whatever, yeah. You know, somebody that you love, you just, I mean, you know, Rick was my he's my buddy, you know. It's like, yeah. Oh, this isn't, no, this ain't happening. So I'm like, you know, get off of him.
Just amazing. Yeah. If I may, this is a little bit changing the topic, but it's always hilarious what happens. And I wish to share with everyone, you'll get a laugh out of this. And also, Sonja can relate to these sort of things. Like, I'm also connected to Gaia, and, you know, but Mother, Father, God. And I have my feminine side, which I recognize it, and it's, which is my left side. But what's been comical over the last month or so is that with Gaia, when we have huge advancements, or when the feminine becomes much more powerful, it's actually physically affecting my vessel as well, because I'm integrated fully within the Mother God aspect. But let's say when the Mother God aspect becomes the most dominant energy here, it is affecting this physical body in such a way that it was comical last night. I was in the shower, having a shower, and you know, I'm washing my chest, and all of a sudden I find out my left boob is pretty good size. It's falling out. I look down and wow,
oh my gosh.
Like, you know, it's twice the size as the one here on the left, and I can still feel it. what you'll identify with, Sonja, you know, with Gaia, when we're birthing the new realities, and some of the other males here can as well, your belly will just swell right up.
Gosh.
Right?
Yes,
and that had occurred with me about overnight, like,
yeah,
you know it. But these are the cool things, and so
it feels just like you're pregnant too. Yeah. It, you know, as a woman, I've had three kids. It's like that, the pressure. I mean, I can't go anywhere because somebody would ask me, "What do you do?" Yeah. And I'm like, then if you tell them you're not pregnant, then they're going to feel like, you know, horrible for saying that. But it's in a split second, your belly can go completely down too. So that has been really something that's been happening to me since, 2015, when it first started happening, the first time I swelled up. And it still does it to this day. Not as frequent, but when it happens, there is no doubt it's got something to do with, you know, this whole universal pull. Yeah.
Oh, it does. I can attest, and Sonja, she had showed me one night, we were on a Skype or something, and she just...
you got to see this. You got to see this.
Yeah. She held the camera. She said her belly just began to swell and swell. And she held the camera right there. She said, "Watch this, Rick. Like, what's going on?" And yeah, you could just see her body, her belly just swell out like if she was pregnant. It was just so amazing. But there's also other ladies that, you know, that has occurred with as well. I was just looking at our viewers. I don't believe any of them are here right now, but they can also attest to this as well. You know, this amazing connection. They are very powerfully connected to Gaia as well.
Yeah, I know a few too that it's happened to them as well. And you know, the first time it happens to you, it's, you know, it's kind of shocking. And I, even a couple of times, after the stomach was so, you know, there's that moment, as you women know that have had babies, that your belly just feels like it's gonna pop. And and then you start getting these like it feels like contractions. It's the, I mean, if you didn't know better, you'd think that you shifted to a body of when you were pregnant, because it's that similar. For me personally, it was that similar. And I thought, this is crazy. If I have a baby, I'm just gonna scream, you know, because at this point, nothing. I mean, I think, what's going to happen next? You know, yeah, I just don't put nothing past anything anymore. Like, are you sure I'm not going to have a baby, Rick? Are you sure?
Like, you know, I got to be 100% kinda, sure.
Yeah, it was kind of, and I had a hysterectomy years ago, you know, it's been 20 years ago. So I know that's not like physically possible in this particular reality. But, you know, hey, I've seen some stuff that I thought wasn't possible. So,
yeah, that's too funny. Well, we're coming up upon your time that I know that you're going to be going here pretty soon. So, what is there anything that you would like to tell the viewers and the listeners? That's really helped you throughout your journey. If there's just anything that you want to share with them, what would you share?
Well, you know, my perspective on that's kind of changed since we talked. And there's so many things that have helped me. And first and foremost, and it's just like, okay, so like earlier I was so nervous.
Yeah.
And Rick stayed on.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
He stayed on. Because he knew that would be comforting to me.
Yeah.
And I've known him, you know, forever. So it's like, without my people, my peeps, it would have been harder. Yeah. Find your person. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be romantic, nothing like that, but find someone to talk to. Buddy, get the buddy system. Yeah. Because when you have someone to talk to, when you start sharing it, it makes you, it's not, it, the fear isn't as big.
Yeah.
And the wow is bigger. So you kind of, when you can share it, it changes it, and it makes, it's comforting because you're not alone. Nobody is alone. I could talk to y'all for days and days and tell you stuff and still forget stuff that's happened. And you know, all that time, it sucked because I was by myself. I was little.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want my grandchildren to think that they're alone. I want them to be able to tell me if they're seeing something.
Mm-hmm.
I want them to feel comfortable and, you know, say, Nana, there's, you know, this happened. And they do. They feel like they can tell me because they know that I am totally open to anything and everybody. And I don't put limitations on anything. So if something crazy happened to them, they could tell me.
Yeah.
That's so important to have someone to tell, be able to talk about this, not like it's, you know, how I used to, it was like mental illness. Nobody ever talked about it.
Right.
You know, or this is not acceptable or that, make this acceptable.
Yeah.
This is a way of life. This is who we are. We are incarnates. We are here to do something spectacular and it needs to be okay.
Yeah.
To be able to talk about it, to be able to share. And your perception is just as important as anyone else's.
Yeah.
They're all different. We're all uniquely, individually designed with source in the center. So, you know, what better place could you be?
Yeah, I love that. So beautiful.
Even on the bad day, connect to that spot.
Yes.
And sometimes it's okay to cry. Sometimes it's okay to have a bad day because 3 days later, then you realize what that bad day was about.
Right.
You know, so, but if you have a friend, if you can find a buddy, if you can find somebody, even if you're just starting out together, it doesn't matter if you're equally yoked or not. I don't believe in that. I think we all have it in us and you can move somebody quick up that ladder.
Yeah.
Find you somebody. That's if I have anything to say, because if I have to say what's helped me the most is being able to pick up my phone and call somebody when something happens.
Yeah.
Remember, you and I were talking the other night, I'm like, you know, my family gets kind of sick of hearing it. You know, this has been this way my whole life. Yeah.
I was like, this is great.
Yeah. And you kind of get, I have found that I kind of get a network now. So it's kind of like I have my own little network. Well, if this one's busy, then I'll call this one. If this one's busy, I'll call this one. But you kind of know who, you telepathically know who's not going to be busy.
Yeah.
So I kind of have figured, I've watched myself doing this to where there's times I got to tell somebody, I got to get it off my chest. I have to share it.
Yeah.
That energy is so strong sometimes and it'll make me swell up.
Yeah.
I'll get red and I'll swell up. And if I don't, and as soon as I start talking to somebody, I can feel myself like relaxing and it kind of just starts leveling out again.
Wow.
So I think that's probably the most important thing, because it's fixing to get real. It's getting real out there.
Yeah. And I agree. I think it's so important that you have a family, you know what I mean? In a sense of being able to, outside of your immediate family, of course, if you can talk to your family too, but like you said, your family, you know.
Well, sometimes, okay, so when you're on different levels, some, you know, it's kind of like, it reminds me of, sometimes there's some speed bumps in the road, you know, and these speed bumps will hit you.
Yeah.
Well, you know, my sister might be busy. If my other or my other, they might not know what that means, or they might not can hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
So somehow intuitively you'll know who to call, and you, but you got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
You start building your own little, it's like your soul family or your own, your people just come into your life and, you know, pay attention, because that those people are going to be your sound board, and they're going to be the ones that you share your crazy stories with that nobody else would believe, and they're going to listen to you. And even if they don't believe you, it's okay.
Yeah.
It's the point of getting it out of you, because when it comes out of you, that's energy flowing, and those things, you can feel it.
Yeah.
You can feel it building. You know you need to talk to somebody. Yeah. I mean, my dog gets... But you know what I mean.
That's so funny. Oh, well, thank you so much, Sonja, for being on the show.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Oh, it's just such a pleasure. I just love interviewing all of you and just having you share your stories, and just it's so inspiring. It's so uplifting. It's so it just gives us a different perspective, you know, and it's just beautiful to see. So, and I know you're busy, and I just really, really appreciate you taking the time and just spending that with us these last 2.5 hours. So thank you.
Well, thanks for letting me come on, because it allowed me to face a fear that I had let grow, you know, over a year, and feels really good.
Good.
It feels really good. Yes. Like a big old ice cream cone. I feel like all fluffy because I've actually made it through it, and I didn't, you know, and it's okay. Even if I said something wrong, it's okay. We're all family here. So, you know, that was a huge milestone for me. So I appreciate you letting me share. Oh, here.
You are so welcome. And maybe we'd have you on again if you want to do that again. So
we'll
kind of play it by ear and see what happens in the outside there. And and Rick, thanks so much for staying here and being here with all of us. You know, it's always a pleasure. Just love having you and your support and
He's like a comfortable blanket.
Yes.
He's
like the big teddy bear that used to, like, you know, teddy bear, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. It's like I stayed and held my hand. And, you know, that is important to have that. So I've been very blessed with all of my peeps. I really have been. So I love you guys.
We love you too.
Okay.
Well, thank you both. And you're both awesome, and we're all together on this. But I guess we're out of time then, Linda. You will not be having a Q&A.
No, Sonja, no, she's got to go. So we have already established that before the show. Yeah, we weren't going to be able to do that. Yeah. Mm. So, but we can have her on again and do a, you know, talk a little bit. You know, her and I can talk and see what she'd like to talk about and see where the energies are, and maybe do a Q&A on that one too, Sonja, if you're up for that, you know.
Yeah, sure. It just... You know, like we talked earlier, the kids will start coming in here in a minute, and I won't be able to focus. And
Yes.
And I've already told them what time. Y'all got to be out of here by this time. But the babies start coming in. They don't know time.
They don't.
They'll be wanting to talk.
So, if I may, so Sonja, where you got the ice broke, meaning you shared the magic of the diamonds, I wish to... So let's say speak more about this in the future and put more things out about it, because it is what I consider, and I know many more when you really look at it, it is the most significant magic perhaps to date with this ascension, and you know, where you actually have the videos of the eyes moving, and you know, others have also, your friends or your family, what have you, have seen it as well, that this is a...
Oh, yeah, they've held them, and they saw them blinking. They, you know, everyone that's touched them, they've seen something different. Wow. They've all had a different experience. So it's very real. And I know that they are of a higher intelligence. I do know that. They're of a higher dimension.
Yeah.
But I think as time goes on, I'll be able to mesh with them a little bit better and understand some of the stuff that, you know, I couldn't understand that at first. It's like I could hear them talking, but then it stopped. And I think at some point I'll be able to understand what's coming through there and where they actually originated from and what I'm supposed to learn from it. It just hasn't all come in yet. But I truly believe that because of how everything else always plays out. We always get the answer. We just have to wait a minute. So
exactly. Well, maybe that's what the next show could be about. We can talk about the diamonds.
Yeah, well, we could talk about whatever. So just let me know.
Yeah. Well, if you and I will talk. We'll talk about that.
Yes.
Kind of see what you want to, you know, share, and we can share part of that too. So
awesome. Okay. Sounds good. Y'all have a great evening.
Love
and
you.
We'll talk soon. Love you too. Love you, Rick, and we'll talk soon.
Love you. Good to see you soon. Have a great day, Sonja.
Okay, all right, you too. Bye-bye.
And thank you again, Rick. Really appreciate it. Just having you here, so.
You're welcome as well. Thank all of you.
Yeah.
Love all of you and peace. And we can chat perhaps after the show.
Yes, I'll give you a call. So I'll definitely do that. And thank you everybody for tuning in who joined us today. Really appreciate all your support and your love. And sorry we didn't get to Q&A. We will do one of those with Sonja at another time, hopefully in the near future. Which I'm sure we will, and all the ones who'll be tuning in afterwards. So we thank you, we love you, and we will see you again real soon in the nearest future. All right. Love you guys. Bye.